Everybody, welcome to episode 2 of Blood and Popcorn. It's just me today, Tiege. I do apologize, we haven't put anything out. My jaw has been locked for the past couple weeks, and Carlos has been working on his band. If you don't know their band, that's called October Flame. Oh, well, it's one of his bands, but he has like 5, so this one's pretty good. You can check them out, they're really cool. It's like a creepy horror band, so that's even more interesting and perfect for the podcast. So what we got today is a review for Before I Wake. It's a movie on Netflix. It is really good. I suggest it. It has an interesting ending, and it kind of got to me a little bit. A heartjerker, or a tearjerker, I guess. Pulled up my heartstrings a little bit. It was really good. Before we get to that, I just want to say that for this episode, we are talking about Before I Wake, the movie. We're going to talk about H.H. Holmes, the first serial killer in America. And we are also going to talk about another abduction and murder from the 1920s, I believe, in Australia, I believe. We're going to talk about those and see where it goes from there. I think I'm going to touch on the movie A Quiet Place as well. That has been on my mind for the past couple weeks. It was so good, but we'll get talk to that when we get there. Okay, so the movie Before I Wake is about a little boy and his dreams come true, as well as his nightmares, which is gonna get a little creepy. So the movie started out like Danny Little horror movies. Sometimes it shows the past, then comes into the present, which is cool. I like that. It doesn't give it away as much, but it gives you a little backstory. You can question it, but it continues with the on day present, or the present day, which is nice. I really like that. But at the beginning, you learn that the couple just got accepted as foster parents to this kid named Cody, who's really left alone in a foster couple's home by himself, and they just took off without him. The social worker said he was guarded, which makes sense. I mean, you leave a kid alone, and he's not going to trust anybody, right? So the kid was less, he doesn't trust a lot of people, which the main couple understands. So they say yes, they'll take him. So there's this little montage of the couple taking down pictures of them and another little kid at their house, obviously letting the viewer know that they lost a son, which made me think about another movie, Godson, if you don't know what that is. It's about a couple who loses their kid and then clones him out of another kid, and it looks like the kid, but it acts nothing like their kid. So that's a creepy movie as well, I'd suggest that. Also during the montage of them erasing their dead son, basically, they showed the dad screwing these pull-up bars in the bathroom above the bathtub, again letting the viewer know that their son probably drowned in the home. I kind of liked how they did that. It didn't throw it out in their face, but just touched on it so they didn't have to blatantly tell you, which I like movies that do that. So the next day is the meeting day. The social worker takes the kid there at the house, which the kid is adorable, but he's not a great actor, but he is adorable. Anyways, the kid is like reluctant at first because he has a shoebox, and the dad's like, oh, let me take that for you. And Cody's like, no, this is my shoebox. So he steps under his arm, but then like 2 seconds later, the kid changes his mind and hands the dad the shoebox, which I thought was pretty good because that's how kids' mind works. Like, they just change their mind split second later. Which I get. So the mom and dad are impressed that they, like, won over his trust already, but probably not. Whatnot. So they show the kid around, and the dad gets super excited about Cody playing his Xbox with them, which is cute and funny to have a grown man look like that. That's really cute. So the movie starts showing going to the mom to the meetings, and you start to guess, mostly, that the meetings are for, like, parents who've lost their child or their children going through a hard time about their child or lost children. Which is good because she's reaching out to help instead of like other movies that I've seen where they kind of just like backs away from everyone and just isolates themselves. I like to see the character who has been through trauma trying to reach out. That's really cool. So the first meeting shows her talking about Cody and bringing him into their home. And the main group guy is just really happy for them. Then the second meeting, which is the mom again, and it's after the first time Cody dreamt of Sean, since he was showing, he remembered seeing Sean in the big picture that they left up. They left one picture up of them and their son. And Cody remembered it. And then she, in the second meeting, talks about how she saw Cody, or Sean, the kid, the dead kid, in the living room. And I think by the third night, they kind of piece it all together. But it was rather quickly. They were just like, oh my god, he dreams of things, and they come true. They saw the butterflies, and that's when they saw Sean for the first time as well. So they're not really asking questions, they're just kind of rolling with it, and because they want to see their dead son so bad, they start showing him videos and whatnot, and doing a whole bunch of things to get Cody to dream of Sean again so they can see him. Now by this time, when he first dreamt of Sean, it was kind of a funny part, it was just him and this, it was just Sean standing there in the portrait and just looking like he wanted their souls. Like, they were just like, oh my gosh, Sean, and he just, like, stood there, non-mood, no facial expression, no anything, he was just smiling, just like in the portrait, and which was kind of creepy. So yeah, once the mom started showing the DVDs, though, she started showing one from a Christmas morning to Cody, so he can dream of Sean's laugh and voice and everything. The dad's like, this is wrong, like, this is all fucked up. But the mom, that night after the video, she makes a pot of coffee and just stays up and to see Sean when Cody goes to sleep so he can dream of him, which I agree is really fucked up. Like, I understand your kid died and whatnot and you're really wanting to see him, but that's not closure. And she actually argues that it's closure and whatnot later on, but it's no, I'm sorry, you need, it's hard to get past it. But if you decide to bring another child into your life, you cannot mess with them in any way about what they dream of. I mean, if you guys have a kid and their dreams come real, but you can't mess with the kid like that. That's not good at all. You can't really mess with anybody like that. It's like if your husband passes away and you get another husband and his dreams come true, you can't mess with that husband and talk about and try to see your old husband. That's bullshit. Anyways, so the next day when the dad comes home from picking up Cody, he notices the mom put the pictures of Sean and them back up so that Cody can see Sean more, and different stuff, like a big old family reunion. That night, though, the dad speaks up finally and tells her how fucked up it is, and I completely agree through the whole thing he was saying. And she keeps saying that he could help him heal, or help them heal, and she just wants to see her son. So the husband keeps being level-headed and telling her it's not healing, it's not really their son that they're seeing, it's not good to do this. But she basically blames the husband for Sean dying, which made me so mad. Like, okay, so I'm gonna bring up 2 points. Number one, Sean was like maybe 5, I believe, I don't know, 4 or 5, we're gonna say. And I mean, he was old enough to talk. Yes, he was short, and yes, you were always supposed to watch your children in the bathroom. She said she left away for like 2 minutes. Okay, she was giving the kid a bath. How is it his fault that the kid drowned? I mean, it's really no one's fault except for the kids, but the kid doesn't know how to get up if he falls under the water, and he can't breathe because he's drowning. So, whatnot. I do not like this woman. Anyway, so Cody gets started, what am I trying to say? Cody starts getting bullied at the school from this kid, and he is a little shit. So while during recess, Cody decides he doesn't feel good, he wants to take a nap in the classroom. So the teacher lets him take a nap. While he's sleeping, the bully kid tries to go into the classroom and I guess just plans on fucking with him. And while Cody is actually sleeping, he actually dreams of the canker man, which is what he said ate his mommy. And that's how his mom died. That's what he told the wife and husband as well. So he dreams of this canker man, and the canker man decides to have the bully kid for lunch. But as this is all happening, this little girl who tried to be Cody's friend, seeing all of this, like she saw the Canker Man run into the bully and just fucking eat him. And she just scream and Cody wakes up and automatically knows what happens. Like he just feels bad. So he just runs out of the school and he's like, nope, some kid ran away, gotta go. So they go home. And that night, the mom really wants to see her dead son in Cody's rooms again. But I'm gonna find out Cody took the last of the coffee, but he's drinking the coffee grinds and water, so it's not gonna work. Like it was just cold water, so it's not working very well. And I guess he fell asleep, or is like in the process of sleep, or like in that weird state of like awake and sleep. And then the evil bully classmate comes back into his dream and attacks him, and he has like these black eyes that are kind of creepy. And he just attacks him. And of course, it's the jump scare. Then the bully. And the bully just attacks him, so the mom goes in and she saves him, and he's like half awake, half asleep, so it really freaks him out. The next day, mom's at work. She decides to abuse her position and talks to the doctor she works for that her adopted son can't sleep, and he prescribes him sleeping pills. But we all know that she's not doing it to help him. She wants to see her dead son again and again. So she gives him the sleeping pills that night. He sleeps pretty quickly too, because he stayed home that day. The dad took him out and they brought him a race car bed, which he was so excited about. And so after they cleaned up and everything, he went to bed, and after dinner and whatnot, well, then the dreams start. First it was they saw Sean in front of the Christmas tree again, and then he was holding this like big box, and then the Canker Man kind of just like comes out of the box, and they're like, "What the fuck?" So they run away and they go into the Cody's room, and the dad's like, "Cody, wake up, wake up!" And the mom's like, "He's not gonna wake up for a couple hours," and he's like, "What did you do?" And so she tells him that she gave him sleeping pills, and the dad knows that either they're all gonna die or one of them is. So he goes to the door as well. They're like both holding on to the door. Canker Man busts in, and then the dad gets eaten, which is bad. I wish the mom did. And the mom falls and knocks herself out. I don't know, fucking hell. So she wakes up, and she wakes up to Cody like on the phone saying, "Oh, she's not awake. Oh, now she's awake. She's awake." I'm like, "Oh my god, this poor kid. Like, I wonder how many times he had to call 911 in his little life. Like, oh my goodness." So yeah, the cops come. They question her about her missing husband. They question her about Cody and all this. So she finally lets them know, like, "Yeah, I gave him sleeping pills. He hasn't been sleeping. I haven't seen my husband, and whatnot, what have you." As she's like telling all this, the kid starts to walk away with like the social worker. And now she's really upset because she can't see her dead son. She doesn't have an adopted kid anymore. Like, I really don't like this woman. Anyways, she goes to see the social worker next day or whatnot and tries to find Cody. She says that he's not your responsibility anymore. That's not your information anymore. But she steals a file from the woman's desks and or desk, excuse me, and does some research. She finds out like the other families Cody has lived with, and one of the parents from a family is in a mental institution, so she decides to go and visit him. So she visits him. He keeps talking about his wife disappeared, probably from the Canker Man, and no one believes him that it was the boy's dreams. He tells her the whole story, how it started with butterflies, and his wife got a bad flu, and Cody had a nightmare of the Canker Man, and the Canker Man ate the wife, just like it took Cody's mom. That was kind of sad. The guy wanted Cody to dream of her, but all of his dreams of his wife were not exactly her, since he couldn't remember all of her, because he was only staying with them with a short amount of time. So it was just like an outline of her, not really her emotions, her voice, not anything. It was just her face, basically. But it was like, it kind of reminded me of Coraline. You know how like the button-eyed parents are all like not really emotion full? It was just like that. But not as creepy. Like the button eyes, man. Gosh, no. Anyway, so the guy actually tries to murder Cody, and that was brings us back to the first thing that happened in the beginning of the movie, where there was a man who tried to murder this little boy, and it was him trying to murder Cody, but that's how he ended up in the institution. And then he tells her that she should try to kill him better than he had, but she refuses and she wants to help Cody, which is awesome. She finds that Cody's mom died at a local hospital and goes there and requests the records of his mom when she checked in. She finds a box of the mom's belongings and goes through it and the mom's file again, and she finds this little butterfly plushie, which it shows that that's the reason Cody likes butterflies, because of his mom. Sad face. And then it cuts to Cody being forced to go to sleep by the staff at whatever place he's staying at. He is put to sleep and the Kanker Man awakens. Somehow the wife finds out where Cody is and goes there in the dead of night, like she's gonna kidnap him, which kind of she does. So jump scare, she's going up the stairs, forewarned, there's moths that fly from the stairs. As she goes up though, she sees the social worker and like one of the nurses are trapped in this goo and they're like held up against the wall. So she passes through this open room and she hears Sean call out to her from this empty bathroom in a bathtub. And of course, she decides to walk in and investigate. She sees the tub filled with this black liquid and Sean's drowning again. And then she falls and looks up, and like she's like her face is like by the tub, and she looks up and Sean's like black eyes are looking at her, and she's just staring him down. And yeah, it was weird. Before the bathroom or the bathtub fills up with black liquid, there's a jump scare of the blanket. Anyways, so yeah, the demon Sean reenacts his death again, and the mom like walks out of the room. She's like, okay, I'm done with this shit. For some reason, the demon comes from behind her and goes up to Cody on the couch. Anyway, so she goes into this other room and she sees Demon Cody, or another Cody, watching Demon Sean drowning on TV. And for some reason, the demon her comes from behind her and goes up to the couch where Cody is and crushes his face, and it becomes Demon Sean. Then the dead dad shows up and it's small jump scare, like right in front of her, and with like moths crawling out of his eye sockets and mouth, and it was really gross. She continues down the hallway after that, like she runs the fuck out of that room. And then she sees another person in the goo, and Cody telepathically tells her that it keeps them safe. That was really weird. She continues and finally finds his room. He's like fast asleep, but then the Kanker Man makes another jump scare, pushes her out of the room, and he screeches and runs at her. Not gonna lie, it was kind of creepy. Just like in the classroom scene. I didn't tell you, but he bent over to look at the little girl because she screamed, and he just like screeches at her. I'm like, what the fuck? She pulls out this butterfly toy, the butterfly plushie, and the Kanker Man stops and calms down. Then she hugs the Kanker guy, and it turns into Cody, and he looks like he had no idea what the fuck just happened. But it's not really Cody, it's just like a projection of him. And she goes into the room, picks him up, and walks him out. So they pass everything, and as they're passing everything, and the dream stuff, like the butterflies and the goo and everything, they all just appear, but the butterflies are actually following them out, and they just go and becomes this light at the top, and it's, like, colorful and whatnot. The sugar creature tries to stop them, and is like, never mind, I understand. And they just let him leave. And they go back home, and the mom explains to him, this is the heart. This is the heartstrings. Heart, okay. So they go back home, and the mom explains to him what she pretty sure has happened. She says that the mom loved Cody a lot, and the mom knew Cody had this dream magic thing. She ended up with cancer and was very sick. She wasn't home, and when she was, she looked like mom, but then when she got sicker, she was in the hospital for a period of time. So when Cody couldn't read, the paper said canker to him, but it really meant cancer. By the end of her life, his dad or someone else brought him in to say goodbye one more time, and interpreted as scary Kanker Man in his mind, because his mom had like really pale skin, her eyes were that looks like black all over her eyes because she couldn't sleep and it was just bruised like a lot. She was very skinny. It looked like the canker man for his mom, and it was just really sad. So he just didn't understand what cancer was. So the mom apologized as well and was like, "I'm sorry for using you. I'm not going to use you again." So yay on her. She didn't piss me off after that, but it was sucky because her husband's still gone. So the very end is just her telling Cody a goodnight story where there's good good endings for everybody that the camper van ate. Like the Billy kid woke up and wasn't a bully anymore. The wife came back to the husband that's in the institution and wasn't sick anymore. And the dad, her husband, got to live with his dead son. So I'm pretty sure that they're all dead since Cody doesn't dream about the camper van anymore. And because she said that the dad was with the dead son. Well, I don't know if to call him a murderer or not, but yeah. I did give it a 9 out of 10. I'm gonna keep the 9 out of 10. Actually, I'm gonna give it an 8 out of 10. 8 out of 10 bloody popcorns. It was really good. Actually, yeah, 9 out of 10. Fuck it. 9 out of 10. It was really good. Of course, it could be better. Anything could be better, I guess, but I really highly recommend watching it. It pulled up my heartstrings at the end. Poor little kid, he didn't know what cancer was. So sad. Alright, so I want to talk about A Quiet Place. I have been waiting for this movie for a few months, and I am so glad. It was so amazing as I hoped for. Like, I love John Krasinski. I don't know. And Emily Blunt, they're so cute. He's such a great actor. She's a great actress. It just all worked out, and I loved it so much. But the one I took from the movie was, just don't ever have kids. I don't know. But it's about these aliens, and they basically hunt off of sound. So to keep everything quiet, like the family, they use sand to walk on instead of gravel. They didn't wear shoes or anything. She didn't know what, couldn't feel anything that would be loud. So they would, if you wore shoes, so they would walk barefoot, which is pretty good, but like, what if your foot gets cut? Like, fuck. Which that happens in the movie, spoiler alert, but you didn't need spoilers because I already told you. Yeah, I really enjoyed it. One part actually did scare me, and another part scared my boyfriend who watched it with me. I loved it. It was written so good. It freaked me out thinking if I lived in a world like that. I am very clumsy. I can be quiet, but when my clumsy ass, I'll drop something. So, yeah. I highly recommend that movie. It was fantastic. I really, another spoiler, I really like the part. It's upsetting, but I like the part in the beginning. They're just showing the family and like the superstore and whatnot. And the kid really wants the shuttle. The sister's like, okay, I'll give it to you, but don't tell mom and dad. Just be quiet. And he's like, okay, thanks. And then the dad's like freaking out when he sees it, and he's like, takes it slowly, takes the batteries out, batteries on the counter, like, first of all, why? And then you know that kid's gonna grab it if, you know, he's a kid, he wants to play. oh my goodness. So they go in, and the kid grabs the shuttle and the batteries before they leave. Well, actually, I think the sister gave him the shuttle, but anyways, he grabs the batteries, and while they're about to crash this bridge, the kid turns on the shuttle and makes this whole lot of noise. And as John's running for his fake son, oh, he's running so good. He's running so fast. I feel so bad for him. He almost dropped the other son. Actually, I think he did not have the other son after this point. I think he just gave it to the mom, or he just dropped the kid. I don't know. Forgot. But he gets the little son gets like attacked by the alien thing. So yeah, that happened. And like right off the bat too, like, holy shit. Yeah, I gave this movie 10 out of 10 bloody popcorns. Definitely go see it if I didn't ruin it for you already. But if you don't care about spoilers and I just spoiled it for you, then still go see it. I think you should. Oh my goodness, I can't tell you how much that movie, like, that's one of my favorite horror movies of all time. Like, I even get, like, kind of freaked out thinking about it. Like, thinking about the ending, thinking about, like, in between. Like, just living in that kind of world. Like, I would last, like, maybe a week, honestly. They lasted, like, 400-something days. I don't know if they're still going, because at the end, well, I don't know. I'm not going to tell you that. I'll give you that in another official review. Figure that out for yourself. I just want to say real quick, out if you are a fully functional adult, okay, and you live in this kind of world where there is aliens that hunt on sound, how are you going to have a child? Like, okay, Emily Blunt did it. Yeah, her character was amazing. They had this whole plan. But how irresponsible is that? Let's talk about that for a minute. Well, less than a minute. Oh my gosh, that kind of just made me so mad. Like, babies are loud. I don't, honestly, like, I feel bad, but I don't think that baby's gonna last in this world. Their family's not gonna last in this world. Anyway, I just had to say that and get it off my chest. I'm sorry. Alright, so next we're going to talk about the abduction of Graham Thorne. This is all from Morbidology. It is a nice little website for a lot of true crime stuff, little mysteries, abductions, unsolved mysteries, anything like that. It's really cool. Go check them out. You don't have to tell them they sent us because we're not sponsored. And they probably don't even know who we are because we're a small little podcast anyway. Alright, so this incident actually changed how lottery winners were publicized in Australia. So, I guess, kudos? Sorry, Graham. He is deceased. But we're going to go through it. So the last time anyone saw Graham Thorne was on July 7th, 1960. His mom, Frieda Thorne, kissed him goodbye and sent off to meet the family friend to pick him up for school. When the family friend got to the pickup spot, Graham was nowhere to be seen. The family friend drove to the boy's house and found he wasn't there either. His family then reported him missing. Later that morning, Frieda received a call stating that they have their son. He demanded £25,000 before 5 p.m. that day and stated that if she didn't get the money, the boy would be fed to the sharks. The sergeant, who was on the case and at their home, Sergeant Larry O'Shea, grabbed the phone and pretended to be Frieda's husband and say they don't have that kind of money to pay the ransom, oblivious to the fact that they just won the lottery, and that was £100,000 on the lottery. Since back then, publicity of lottery winners were big and everyone knew them by the next day, the Thorne family was forced into the stage light and received a lot of media. The kidnapper knew that. The kidnapper called again a little bit later with instructions to put the money in two paper bags. Investigators searched the area but turned up nothing. The next day, however, they found Graham's empty school case near a bush where he was supposed to meet the family friend. Several days after, they found a school cap, raincoat, and lunchbox less than a mile from where his school was, his school case was. Posters of the missing boy went up all over town with an award, but nothing turned up. Then, more than a month later, the body of a boy was found in a vacant land in Sydney. It was Graham. He was gagged with a scarf and wrapped and tied in a blanket. His body was wedged underneath a rock, and the autopsy concluded that he had died about 24 hours after he was abducted. Forensics find two types of cypress foliage, three different human hairs, including a dyed blonde hair, and a Pekingese dog hair. Soil samples also found fragments of pink-colored limestone mortar, and an eyewitness came forth and said that they saw Graham with his kidnapper and that led them to Stephen Leslie Bradley. When they went to Stephen's home, they found two cypress plants, pink mortar used in the building of the house, and his wife had just dyed her hair blonde, and they had a Pekingese dog. By the time the police arrived, he and his family had fled. But they did find out that he bought a ticket to England via boat and met them coming out of the exit of the boat, stepping off the ship. He confessed to his crimes immediately. He was sentenced to life in prison on March 29th, 1961, and he died of a heart attack on October 6th, 1968. That is a very sad story, but it did change the way that lottery winners are publicized, so that's good. Like I said, was stated before. But poor little Graham did not need to go out that way. And to lead the family on to think he was still alive to get that money, such bullshit. Like, I get it, like, okay, if you're a murderer, you want to have them pretend the kid's still alive, but that is such bullshit. Like, if you got that money, what would you tell your family? Like, oh, I won the lottery? Bitch, you're in the newspapers. Oh, I got a promotion? Alright, now you want to hear some really messed up shit? This is about America's first serial killer, H.H. Holmes. Now, when you hear the word Holmes or think of Holmes, you think of Sherlock Holmes, the great detective, movies, books, TV show, things like that. But this Holmes is not a great detective. He was a horrible, horrible man. We'll get into it now. Alright. I also wrote about him on our Tumblr page as well. But I'm about to read all that to you now. He was born in 1861 in New Hampshire as Herman W. Mudgett. H.H. Holmes will he later be known as. He was very smart and excelled in everything in school, which had the other kids jealous, of course. And he was bullied. The bullies found out that Herman was afraid of skeletons, so two of them knew of that, and they pushed him toward a skeleton one day with its arms outstretched, like it was going to grab him. It scared him so bad, but it also opened the door to his curiosity. In 1882, Herman enrolled in the University of Michigan Medical University, where he perfected two of his talents, anatomy and chemistry. He had the opportunity to be opening on human cadavers, and thus his blood thirst was born. He graduated from the University of Medical School in 1884, and during the 2 years he was traveling, he perfected his calling skills as different jobs. Since he didn't want anyone following him or looking to things he did, he finally changed his name to Henry Howard Holmes. He found work immediately in Chicago in 1886 at a drugstore, E.S. Holton. Several months after Holmes started to work at the drugstore, the husband dies of natural causes. Then his wife goes missing for a few months later, and after selling the drugstores to Holmes. Kind of suspicious. He then scammed creditors and made different inventions to scam people, such as mineral water elixir, which was just the town's water. In 1888, he buys the lease from a vacant property across from the drugstore. Around the time Jack the Ripper was murdering prostitutes in London, Holmes was just finishing his blueprints to his torture building. The bypassers that always gaze upon the building nicknamed it the Castle. It was so huge. Holmes built in the second floor, different rooms to kill and torture people, and made it a labyrinth so people would get lost but he could find them. He knew where they were. He had actually a trap door to dump the bodies that led to the basement of the building, and in the basement it included an acid vault and a crematorium. After getting rid of the skin and muscle on the bones, he would clean up the bones and sell the skeletons to schools and doctors. Creepy. Just think, like, one of the doctors, his wife has been missing for a few months, and he gets this new skeleton, and it's exactly her frame and everything. Oh my gosh. A guy named Benjamin Pitzel answered an ad in the paper looking for a carpenter for Holmes' new building. They became pretty close friends once he started working for him. Holmes became like another part of Pitzel's family. When the World's Fair came to Chicago, he decided to remodel the third floor and get new decorations and beds and everything to house the visitors and foreigners. He often preyed on women and children who flaunted their wealth as well. Holmes suited many women in his lifetime, and he got Julia Connor, one of his many women, pregnant. When she demanded marriage, since she already had Pearl, her daughter, he agreed as long as he could do an abortion on her. She agreed, and her daughter were never seen again. In 1892, Holmes had another mistress, Emmeline Singrad. He sent her to the bank vault he had and locked her in and suffocated her. In 1893, Minnie Williams became Holmes's new private secretary and eventually his mistress. She had the beneficiary of a property in Fort Worth, Texas, valued at $40,000. He then murdered Minnie and her younger sister after they signed the property to him. In 1894, Georgina Yoke married Holmes, becoming his third wife, though he married her under the name Henry Mansell Howard. It seems only that his wives actually lived their entire lives, not his mistresses. Pitzel's drinking problem became worse, and Holmes feared that Pitzel would tell about his work during one of those drunken spurs. So Holmes suggested a plan to basically trick the insurance company that him and his wife had for life insurance that Pitzel, that they got once Pitzel was dead, since Pitzel was worried about money all the time. The plan was to fake Pitzel's death using a cadaver and have the money go to his wife, and Pitzel will be hidden for a while. Pitzel and Holmes go on a cross-country road trip to commit the fraud. Holmes gets arrested trying to commit the fraud at a drugstore in 1894 in St. Louis. He comes later bailed out by his wife Georgina. When they get to Philadelphia, Pitzel then goes by the name of B.F. Perry. They open a shop in Philadelphia where the scam is going to take place. One of the inventors that were supposed to see them comes to the shop and finds Pitzel dead on the second floor. Holmes actually did kill Pitzel with chloroform and burned Pitzel's face. Since somebody needed to identify the body, they called upon Carrie, who was Pitzel's wife, but she and the three youngest children were very sick. So Carrie sent the second eldest child, Alice, to identify her father's body with Holmes. Carrie still believed at the time that her husband was safe and alive. Upon returning back to Chicago, Holmes didn't have Alice with him. Carrie then questions him about it, and he said that they were both safe and then talked to her into sending the other two children with their father. During this time, the insurance company gives the money to Carrie and Holmes, and Holmes finagles most of the money away from her. He then spends a lot of time traveling with Carrie and the other kids. Holmes is finally found by the Pinkertons on November 17th, 1894 in Boston. He is suspected of murdering Pitzel and the children that they could not place. The detective follows Alice's letters that she was writing to her mother that were never sent, and found all three children's bodies around the country. Howard's body was found charred in a little house oven. The remains of the two girls were found in Toronto. On July 19th, 1895, the Chicago police enter Holmes's Castle of Terror. This is where it gets crazy as well. The police find human bones and animal bones, bloody woman's undergarments, and a wooden dissection table with dry blood on it. Police were given a list of missing people from the Woods Vale, and 50 of those missing people were traced back to the Castle of Horrors. As newspapers were giving Holmes different nicknames, people wanted to buy the Castle of Horrors and turn it into a type of murder museum. But right before anybody could buy it, it was burned down. While Holmes is still in prison, he decides to write his own autobiography called Holmes's Own Story. On October 28th, 1895, was the final day of the trial, the first day of the trial. Carrie Pitzel comes to the courthouse during the third day of trial. She finally sees the letters Alice never sent. The judge and everybody there then sees his horribleness once more. He did not show any remorse, nor care that she was crying over her dead children. Holmes then is found guilty of first-degree murder and is sentenced to hang on May 7th, 1896. Before his hanging, he wrote his confessions about every murder that happened, showing his true monstrous side. Now that is some nightmare fuel for you. Super crazy how someone could do that. But I'm not gonna lie, the Castle of Horrors does sound really cool. And it was a loose grip for American Horror Stories hotel season. And I'm sorry if you hear knocking, that's my neighbors above me. That's what's loosely based on, so I thought that was pretty interesting. Alright, so that is all I have today. Hopefully we'll be doing more episodes in the future, hopefully the near future. I know Carlos will be doing more band stuff until about June or July. And then again, his band is October Flame. They are a horror band, which is pretty cool. His other bands are pretty cool. Check them out on Facebook. And yeah, thank you for listening very much. I really hope you like it. And if you have any recommendations of what we want to go over, what you want us to talk about, let us know in the comments below. Let us know on Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, anything we're on. We're on all three. So, have a great night, and don't get too scared.